about the other half?
Eh?
Another one of those.
Oh, ta. Have you got a large one?
I've had no complaints so far.
He had to play that dirty old lecher, and he perfected that dirty old lecher.
Yes, I'm fine. Luckily, my face broke me fall.
Oh, you want to be careful, dear. You don't want to spoil your looks.
What more could you do to that face?
For the sort of career that Sid had, I mean, his looks were a great asset. Yeah. I mean, they were as big an asset to him as Tyrone Powers were to him, you know.
I just can't imagine what's happened to my boyfriend. I sent him for a bottle of Coke about half an hour ago.
Perhaps he's looking for a bucket of Coke.
You're very humorous.
He enjoyed flirting. That never worried me in the slightest, because I always knew he was coming home with me.
Although known for being the archetypal cheeky Cockney, Sid was actually born to Jewish immigrant parents in Johannesburg, South Africa. He was already 33 and on his second marriage when he arrived in England on Christmas Day 1946 to seek his fortunes as an actor. He had spent his war years performing in the Army Entertainment Corps, and it was only a chance meeting in London with fellow unit member Olga Lowe and her husband Tore that led to his big break.
How the hell do you get started here? Says Sid. And so Tore said, I'm going up for a part of a gangster and Olga will be the mole. And then he looked at Sid and he said, you'd be more of a gangster than I am. Sid came up with me. He got the part and I didn't. That's how he got started.
I'm staying here, like I said.
You ought to get out, Johnny.
What, to lose me alibi? Not likely.
What alibi?
You, sweetheart. If anyone checks up, I've been here all night.
Well, I can't do that, Johnny.
You're in, you're in this up to your neck.
Sid was immediately swamped with work. He would accept stage work whenever he could, alongside almost any film role he was offered, no matter how small.
Hey! I'll do you for that!
Oh, that'll have been on the road all day.
Still, they're looking for somebody.
He had the highest daily rate of any character actor in the film business. You know, daily rate, obviously, you know, how much they get per day. Double anybody else. But it was worth it. One take, James, to be in and out and saving money.
Anyone ever give you a thicker, Nuxie?
Not without paying cash for it.
Sid was someone who had to be working. That's why he probably took so many smaller roles in the early days. It was a day's work, 2 days' work, or 3 days' work, and that, as far as he was concerned, was paying the rent.
Meanwhile, in his private life, Sid's second marriage had collapsed. But it was not long after that he met and fell in love with 19-year-old stage starlet Valerie Ashton.
He didn't mean anything to me when I first met him. I thought he was conceited and rather full of himself, actually. He irritated me. I thought, leave me alone, you know. That old black man. But when I finally went out with him, it was just electric, and I fell madly in love with him. That old black
magic that. By 1952, Valerie had made it third time lucky for Sid when she agreed to tie the knot. Fingers up
and down my side. I hadn't had that much experience until I met Sid. I mean, he was that much older than I. He was only 8 years younger than my father. Same old tingle that I feel inside. He was extremely jealous of me, I must say. He couldn't stand it if anyone touched me or came over and spoke to me for too long. What were you talking about? But we had tremendous trust and we were devoted. He just had something about him that won you over instantly.
I can't help it, I'm just attractive to women. What a boat race looks like doesn't mean a thing. They take one look at me and they go, that boy's been around. Strength, confidence, that's what they want. Somebody who's going to dominate them.
Dear, oh dear, 1960 and they haven't advanced since the club on the head and drag them off by the hair days.
I think secretly he wanted to be a matinee idol. Deep down in his heart, he knew he would never be because he didn't have the looks. He wasn't a Cary Grant.
10 minutes can make you look 10 years younger. I'll give it a couple of hours, I think.
But as far as the men behind a new comedy series were concerned, Sid had the perfect face.
Hancock's half hour.
For radio.
Sid was very, very unsure, very reluctant to do it. He said, no, I've never done radio, I don't know whether, you know. So, the first broadcast. And we amazed to see Sid come to the microphone. He had this hat on, that trilby hat, down over his eyes, and the script up in front of his face, so the audience couldn't see him.
And shaking.
He didn't feel that happy playing comedy. He was far happier playing the straight man in what he termed as the heavies. That, to Sid, was easy. But comedy he found quite difficult. And he learnt everything about comedy, I think, from Hancock.
I am not a comedian. I'm a sort of actor that does comedy parts. But it's hard work, believe me. You rely so much on your writers. So much.
Was pompous, airs and graces. And as a contrast, Sid was such a common layabout who pricked the pomposity of Hancock all the time. We all love to see pomposity pricked.
Is there no room for the aesthete anymore? The delicate courtship? The locket of hair for her to wear around her neck?
I don't go for any of that rubbish, mate. A quick goer with the choppers with a brush full of striped toothpaste and straight at it.
At its peak, Hancock's half hour attracted an incredible 70% of the viewing public. But that wasn't enough to stop Tony from wanting to go it alone.
As the years went on, Tony became more and more aware that it was becoming, in the public's eye, a double act. It was becoming like Morecambe and Wise. It was, you know, Hancock and James. You know, wherever Tony was on the street, someone said, "Hello, where's Sid? How's Sid?" You know.
I'll never forget what you've done for me.
Yeah, well, try.
They'd done radio, they'd done records, they'd done television, and Tony was ready to move on. He wasn't the most tactful person in the way he broke off relationships. But sometimes it's easier to cut it, so you walk away.
Sid was absolutely shattered because they'd been very close friends. Now, where I wasn't friendly outside of working, Tony and Sid did see each other socially, so it was a terrific wrench.
And of course, you know, and then Sid, you know, was faced with this dilemma: would he support someone else, or would he be a star in his own right? And of course, he did become a star in his own right.
The early 1960s saw Sid become one of the biggest comedy stars in the country. He stayed at the BBC for two more series, Citizen James and Taxi, but neither reached the heady heights of Hancock's Half Hour. The role that turned things around came after a move to ITV in 1966 as cheeky chauffeur George in the runaway rating success George and the Dragon.
Now, I know that you are always having a crafty nip of the Colonel's brandy.
That is a lie. May I be struck dead this minute?
Oh, George, you do take the most terrible risks sometimes.
Whereas in the past, Sid had been a con man, a vagabond, a likeable rogue, it's slightly changed with George and the Dragon because he became a more rounded character.
Don't tell me you believe it all started with Adam having a nibble at Eve's golden delicious.
I hope I am enlightened enough to know it wasn't just her apple he was after.
People suddenly started to like Sid.
You see, I'm telling you, it's allegorical, it's been proved. We all come from monkeys.
You haven't come very far, have you?
But the 1960s were even more significant for Sid because of one film role. In 1960, he accepted a part in a low-budget British comedy, Carry On Constable. It was a part that would lead to 18 more appearances in the most successful comedy franchise in British film history.
But,
Sid is remembered today with more adoration than he had at the height of his career, because the public today, for some strange reason, regard the Carry-Ons as the personification of comedy. You think of Carry-On, you immediately think of Sid James.
Yeah,
And a bit of luck on the cheesies.
OK, you'll have to give me some tips.
I've got a good one for you.
What's that?
Don't bend over in a tight skirt.
One gets cast, really, within your own sort of confines. And within that confine, I think that Sid was clever, but probably, no, he wasn't stretched.
Your friend, the Duke de la Plume de my aunt.
What about him?
He's the living image of Camembert.
Blair. What, you mean the leader of the French secret police?
The big cheese himself?
There were certain elements, I think, that he couldn't take. I don't think he was particularly happy with Kenneth.
Kenneth irritated Sid because of his mannerisms, and Sid was a real gentleman, and when you've got somebody in the caravan or wherever you're sitting when you're not shooting, doing very loud farts and almost doing an orchestral arrangement of farting, I mean, that was not Sid's sense of humour.
And may his radiance light up your life.
And up yours.
Cowboy was his very favourite. He did practice for ages with the holster and the guns until he got it absolutely to perfection. Anything he took on, he did well.
I wonder what they wanted.
He knew that they weren't Oscar-winning movies. In fact, once or twice he said, oh, it's a load of crap, but it's well-paid crap, you know. And it's commercial. And they were very popular and they sold all over the world. And it was a job of work.
But with the success of the Carry-Ons came a reputation for Sid. It bore an image of a lifestyle based around gambling, drinking and womanising.
It's much easier when you look at a man who played all those dirty lechers and leery men and say, oh, he's a chain smoker, oh, he's a drunk, oh, he's out with every bird he sees, because that fits the character.
I mean, he was cheeky, but he wasn't going around sort of pawing females or hands up their skirts or debauched or drunk or a lech or any of these things that are attributed to him now.
Out of the tree of life I just picked me a plum. You came along and everything started into hum.
Sid's wife Val and Sid's children were very special. They were in a category that was totally protected. He would do anything for them. He would earn anything for them. He wanted them to have the best, the finest, all the things that he thought he was deprived of in his early years. There was nothing that he wouldn't get for them.
Money to him was a commodity to enjoy. It wasn't something which he believed in being as a saying. He wanted it because that was a security. But if you asked him that, to him, money was to enjoy.
If he was earning it, he'd say spend it. You know, he didn't worry about tomorrow except for us as a family. Money didn't matter to him at all. As long as he had enough in his pocket to do what he wanted to do, that's all that mattered to him.
My abiding memory of Sid would be the back of him. Leaning over the end of a bar in the pub, losing the landlord's telephones, and it'd be, to his bookie. And it was always, and Hancock would be in hysterics.
Saturdays was always a big deal in the house, so he'd always stop rehearsals to make sure he was home in time to watch the racing on television. And if the kids came into the room and there was a race on and he was shouting his horse home and it won, he'd say to the children, right, when the next race is on, you come back and stand in exactly the same position and you don't move, and so that you'll be lucky for me for the next race.
Now relax, think carefully, winners only. Here we go.
Sid was a compulsive gambler. I must say I never, never tried to stop him.
Be with the third. He's never even been placed. You must be out of your tiny mind.
I just asked him to try and control it because it was getting a bit out of hand at one stage. But it was something he loved, and you can't take that away from somebody.
But Sid's image did catch up with him. In 1966, he suffered a serious heart attack. It was a sure sign that his lifestyle was taking its toll on his health.
Have you been smoking, Mr. Roper?
When Sid had his first heart attack, he didn't really appear to cut down on anything. He still smoked, he still drank, he still gambled. And after a week or two, people forgot he'd had this heart attack, because he was still the same Sid James.
Yes, he smoked, and yes, he drank. But in those days, everybody did. We didn't have one-to-one gymnastic managers who came past at 6 o'clock in the morning and made sure you worked. We didn't have warnings on cigarettes to say this is injurious to your health.
Now, are you going to have your usual breakfast or do you want food?
No, thanks, no food, just a cup of tea and a fan.
But I needed it.
He liked to keep working, and even after his first heart attack, he just wouldn't stop working and listen to the doctors. And, of course, you've got to relax sometime.
He didn't turn anything down, Sid. He worked too hard. He was a workaholic. And sometimes he'd work in the theatre at night and film during the day, far too much. But I didn't push him to do that. That was his own decision. He was his own boss.
In 1973, Sid's image seemed to have caught up with him again, as rumours began to circulate among friends and colleagues that he was involved in an affair with Carry On co-star Barbara Windsor.
I'm Nurse May. I was told to report here, sister.
I'll be with you in a moment.
Hi.
Sid obviously had a soft spot for Barbara, although nothing was happening. And Barbara then was married, as everybody knows, to this gangster called Ronnie Knight. And Ronnie Knight was getting wind of the fact that they were getting a little bit close. Not a fair, mind you. And Sid goes home. I think he and Val were out that night. And there is an axe in the floor. He left his card.
I always thought it was much more of a almost a father-daughter relationship, because I can remember talking to them on the floor, and if I use a word that Barbara didn't understand, she would say to Sid, "What does that mean?" And he would look down at her and say, "That means so-and-so and so-and-so, as a father would a daughter."
The truth was, yes, of course he did have an affair. But it didn't rock our marriage. He was completely honest with me. I accepted it. He told me it couldn't end straight away because he had to do another film with the lady in question. And he said, "Darling, it's not going to be easy, but will you stand by me? I've made a mistake. I'm being honest with you. We have had an affair, but my life is to be with you."
Sid and Barbara, for some reason, after all those years of working together, suddenly took an interest in one another. But then I think Sid was coming to an age where men are very vulnerable, and the attentions of a young, attractive girl are very hard to resist.
I mean, what can one say? It's what I wanted, so I didn't mind how long I had to wait. I just stood by him and I helped him. I helped him through it, because that's what he wanted, and that's what I did. It was a hiccup, but our marriage was too strong for it to be severed. We got over it, and we had two wonderful years after that together.
By the mid-70s, a decade after his first heart attack, Sid still showed no sign of cutting his workload. He'd just finished his final Carry On film, Carry On Dick. He was starring in two primetime ITV shows, Carry On Laughing and the Generation Gap sitcom Bless This House. And at the same time, he was also touring the country in the highly successful stage comedy The Mating Season. By April 1976, the production had arrived in Sunderland.
I said to him, "Are you feeling okay?" He said, "Well, no, I have got a bit of indigestion." I said to him, "Are you sure it's indigestion? It's not that pain," because we called it that pain. He said, "No, but if I'm not feeling any better tomorrow, we'll let you call a doctor. But you promise me that you won't let any member of the cast know that I'm not feeling very well." I'll never forget that last look, and I kissed him, and he looked back at me as much to say, "Promise me you're not going to say anything." And that was the last time I saw him. I went out front, as I always did. I was in the dress circle with the company manager.
I came on in the second scene of the first act as his mistress. Sid was on the sofa with me, and I had a very low-cut dress. And he looked down at my boobs, and his head went back onto the sofa. The audience laughed. He didn't give me my next cue. I thought, that's strange. It's a gag. What's he doing to me? You know, first time I've known him to ad lib.
The audience were roaring with laughter. They thought it was all part of the act. I knew instantly. We all rushed downstairs.
The manager went in front of the curtains and said, is there a doctor in the house? Well, the audience roared again. They thought this was terribly funny. Then he had to say again, no, this is serious.
And I just stood in the wings for a few seconds while the doctor came down and was working on Sid. And he looked terrible, but he looked peaceful. And I thought, thank God he's not suffering. But I hadn't realised then that he was dead.
Sid James died on stage at the Sunderland Empire on Monday, the 26th of April, 1976. He was 62.
I think he should be remembered very fondly as an icon, as somebody who was much loved in our business and much loved by the general public. The more
I see. When he came on a stage and he laughed or he smiled, every person in the audience felt much better for it.
He just had that look and feel about him that sort of radiated some sort of pleasure. You know.
I just love Sid deeply, and I'll continue to do so for the rest of my days. Can you imagine
how much I love you? Well, Benidorm returns this week, and with it comes a...